celebrate. We're going to have a great month as we're celebrating the birth of our Savior, Jesus Christ, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And we're going to talk, beginning today, about the gift of Christmas. For 4 weeks, I want to share with you different perspectives of Christmas. Now, we've heard the Christmas story hundreds of times, but I hope this morning and in the next 3 weeks that I'm able to extract some things out of different parts of the Christmas story that will impact you practically. If you have your Bibles this morning, would you stand for the reading of the Word of God and turn with me in the book of Matthew chapter 2. I want to begin reading in verse 1. Begin reading in verse 1. And after Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star in the east and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had called together all of the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Christ was to be born. "In Bethlehem, in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for out of you will come a ruler who will be shepherd of my people Israel." And then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and make a careful search for the child. For as soon as you find him, report to me so that I too may go and worship him." And after they had heard the king, they went on their way. And the star they had seen in the east went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. And when they saw the star, they were overjoyed. And on coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother. And they bowed down and worshiped him. And then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, incense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route. Let us pray. Lord, we rejoice in the season of the birth of your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, as we talk these next 4 weeks about the gift of Christmas, I pray that different aspects and perspectives of the Christmas story will be gleaned from the Word of God, and that we can practically apply these truths to our own lives today, thus enjoying a better Christmas season. Lord, for the lonely, I pray that you will be that friend. For the lost, I pray that you will help find and rescue them. And Lord, for those today that are here and looking forward to this season of celebrating your birth, I pray that we will rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory, because the half has not even yet been told. In Jesus' name we pray, and everybody said, amen. You may be seated this morning. God bless you. Well, as I've already said, we've heard this story proclaimed hundreds of times. And during the next 4 services, I want to share with you a series of messages entitled The Gift of Christmas. Today, I want to share the thought, a gift worth giving. This morning, you should have received a handout, an outline of the message, and I hope that you will follow along with me as we fill in the blanks together. And as we glean from this simple yet profound message of God's Word, because the best way that I know to preach about Christmas is to take the obvious and pull truths from it for daily living. It was the wise men that started it all. I'm talking about the gift giving, receiving gifts, giving gifts. In fact, there are 2 things that I would like for you to notice by way of a simple introduction to this message. The first thing that impresses me about the wise men is that they gave their gifts personally to Jesus. They gave their gifts personally. You do realize that these were wealthy men from another country. Believe it or not, I don't know if you knew this, but they were from Iraq. Think about that. And they could have easily, because of their wealth and status, they could have easily sent their gifts. But I am impressed that these men felt that it was their mission in life to personally bring their gifts and present them to the Christ child themselves. As you read the story here in Matthew chapter 2, you see the personal part of these wise men's involvement just pops out at you. Look at verse 2. It says, "We saw his star in the east, and we have come to worship him." In verse 9, the Bible said, "And they went their way." In verse 10, when they saw the star, notice, they were overjoyed. In verse 11, they came into the house, they saw the child, they worshiped and bowed down, and they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts. Secondly, I want you to notice that their gifts were not only personally given, but they were properly given. How many of you know there is a right way to give gifts? Amen. It can't be begrudgingly. It can't be with expecting to receive something in return. No, it was more than a material gift of gold and frankincense and myrrh. It was a gift of worship. It was a gift of adoration. These men wanted to glorify and honor and praise the Messiah, the King of the Jews. There are three kinds of gifts I want to talk about today that we give at Christmas time. The first one is this, write it down. It is called a gift for a gift gift. And by your response, you know what I'm talking about. Amen. It's a gift for a gift gift. Now, we get a gift from somebody, and we try to figure out how much it costs so that we can run out to the mall and give them a gift of similar value. And every one of us has at some time in our life given a gift for a gift gift. And the characteristics of this kind of giving is that the person who does this has a mental picture of the natural value of the gift given and received. It's like the person that says, quote, "I gave them something really nice, but didn't get anything in return." They keep score, so to speak. And this approach is what feeds the cash registers of our department stores every Christmas year. Every Christmas Eve in Broward County, Florida, there are literally thousands of people going to stores at the last minute because they just got a gift for a gift gift, and now they've got to purchase a gift for a gift gift gift. Amen. It happens every year, doesn't it? It's those people that worry over the cost of spending the same amount or more on a gift that they're giving than one that they receive. And how many of you know the same thing happens with Christmas cards? You know, the late cards that you get, it's probably because the person didn't expect a card from you, so to save face, they hurried out and sent your card at the last minute. And how many of you know there's nothing worse than you getting a Christmas card on Christmas Eve from somebody that wasn't on your list? Oh my, what will I do now? I'll send them a card late and blame the post office. It's called a gift for a gift gift. Here's the second kind of gift that we give at Christmas time, and I call it a gift for a favor gift. Say that. The person who gives this kind of gift, they don't expect a gift in return, but what they do expect is for you to do some nice things for them. Amen. And this also is the kind of person that likes to keep score, because they always want to be one up on you. Amen? They want to have IOUs out. And companies do this consistently. You know, at the end of the year, your boss or your company will come by and they'll give you a honey-baked ham or a smoked turkey or some kind of a Christmas bonus, expecting a favor from you when you return to work after the holidays, right? Now, they don't give you a turkey expecting you to give the company a turkey in return. However, I think it would be somewhat humorous if you turned around and bought a turkey for the company. No, they don't expect you to give them a gift, but what do they expect? A favor. They expect you to be a good employee. They expect you to keep your mouth shut. They expect you to have a positive attitude and keep the production going. And along about March of the new year, you run into an issue at work and you decide to speak up about it, and here's what they say. Didn't we give you a turkey at Christmas time? Remember? Why? We've all done that before. We've given gifts, not expecting a gift in return, but yet we anticipate a few favors throughout the year, don't we? But there's a third kind of gift I want to talk about today, and this is what I want to zero in on. I call these grace gifts. This third kind of gift is what the wise men teach me about, a grace gift. And the best way that I can describe a grace gift is that it's a gift that is unrepayable. Is that okay? You can't pay back a grace gift. And of course, the gift comes in many ways from God. How many of you know that eternal life is that kind of a gift, a grace gift? Why? Because we can't work for it. We can't buy it with money. Or what can a man give in exchange for his soul? Indeed, we cannot repay it. And I believe as children of God, we too need to learn how to give grace gifts, gifts that cannot be paid back. I was at a conference one time and Dr. John Maxwell told and shared the story of a grace gift that he received one year from one of his adopted daughters. She had sat down and wrote a 2-page letter to him about how grateful that she was that God had sovereignly placed her in a godly Christian home where the influence of love and Christ had kept her soul. And John Maxwell shared how that he placed that precious gift in a file and said that it would be cherished forever because there was absolutely no way that that gift could be repaid. So there's two ways that you can determine a grace gift. Here's the first. It is impossible to measure a grace gift by its cost. You see, it's impossible to measure the cost of a grace gift. When I was pastoring my first church back in the 80s in Plymouth, Michigan, my late wife and I had only been there for about 3 months. It was a small church. We began with just 19 people. And about 3 months after our arrival, a new family walked through the door. It was a husband and wife. If I remember correctly, it was around Easter time. And they were very distinguished. And I later found out that their names were Keith and Karen Biggs. And they were business owners. He was a commercial drywall company owned. And he was also a general contractor who built custom homes. And so my wife and I got to know them, and we became friends, and over time we got very close, and God had saved them. They came back to the Lord. They had been away from the Lord and out of church for many years, and they came back and became members of our church and leaders in our church and became more like family. And in fact, even to this day, 40 years later, I'm closer to the Biggs family than some of my own members of my own family. So one day, about a year into their attending our church, He said, "Hey, Pastor, I want to take you to lunch." And he sat us down. He and I were at the table. And he said, "Pastor, I just want to bless you and your family." And he said, "You know that I'm a general contractor." And he says, "I want to build you a house for free." And of course, I was stunned. He said, "You find a lot and purchase the lot, and I'm going to build the house at no cost to you. For the labor, for overseeing the projects, to secure the permits, to oversee everything until the CO, when I hand it to you, and the only thing that you have to pay for are the cost of the materials. I'll do everything else, and that's going to be a gift that I want to present you." And then he said this, and he said, "Pastor, I don't want to do this one time. I want to do this three times for you. If you and your wife are willing to move into the first house and live there for a period of time, put it up for sale, take the proceeds of what you make off that house, we'll do a second house, sell that house, and the third house that I build for you will be mortgage free." Those are pretty good friends. So we built the first house, we bought the land for the second house, and then God called me to Canton, Ohio. True story. But our relationship with that family is still very close. In fact, I spoke with Karen yesterday. Keith passed away, my best friend, 9 weeks after my wife died back in 2014 from cancer. But I'm Uncle Rod to the family. I'm the surrogate dad. And to this day, 40 years later, we are the best of friends. But I said all of that to say this. I could never repay him for his generosity to my family. And isn't it unfortunate what we have done with Christmas and gift giving? And we need to somehow turn this thing around. And we need to stop running down to the department store every time that we think of someone else and start passing out some grace gifts that will really last. Here's another thing about grace gifts, is that they are usually non-material. Let me suggest one. How about a togetherness gift this year? What do you mean, Pastor? I mean, what about you clearing your calendar and spending some alone time with your family? That's a grace gift. Maybe your grace gift could be a service gift, like doing something for someone who can't do anything for themselves or for you. I had a pastor friend that told the story one time. He pastored a large church. And he talked about this very inconspicuous man that attended his church. He wasn't well known. Nobody really knew his name. And he was a one talented guy. But every week he would stop by the pastor's office and he would run errands for the pastor. He would take his car and get it washed. He would run his clothes and pick them up at the dry cleaners. And anything the pastor needed done as an errand throughout the week, this one talented man that nobody in the church knew his name, he provided this service to his pastor for 7 years. Every week he came to the office and provided. That was a grace gift. Let me tell you another story. When I was pastoring in Canton, Ohio, there was an older single lady that was never married. Her name was Beth Paul, and she was a prayer warrior, an intercessor, and had the gift of encouragement. I served for 5 years as the pastor of that church, and every week, in fact, in my Bible, I still have her name with dates written beside scriptures that God would speak to her about, and she would either text me or hand me a note or send me a card or an email of a scripture, and I would write it down with her name next to it and the date that I received it, just as a word of encouragement from her. That is a grace gift. It's a gift that I can never repay. It has no monetary value, but God helped the church to bring Christmas back into what it really is. It's not about material things. It's about non-material things. It's about a joy that's unspeakable, like we sang about earlier. It's about making memories that last a lifetime with family and friends, and it's about gifts that are not gifts of monetary value, but they are grace gifts. So now I have finished my intro. Let me get to the message. I want to talk to you about five things about giving. I thought how beautiful it was of the video that was played during our worship and giving time, and how it really preached my message today in just 2 minutes. Sorry, I'm a little long-winded. But it's such a simple story, isn't it? But these wise men, these magi, these wealthy Iraqis, teach me five things about giving. Here's the first. How about give an unexpected gift this year? That's something that I learned from these wealthy foreigners. Give an unexpected gift to someone. Nobody expected the wise men to give anything. They weren't Jews. They have no significant role to play in the birth of the King of the Jews. They had only heard about the birth. And you talk about a surprise. These men came unexpectedly. You do realize that it took these magi months to travel from Iraq to the place of the birth of our Savior. And they had to work their way to the city of David. Now, on the other hand, King Herod could have been expected to present the most noble of gifts, but not these three guys. So first of all, you need to think of someone that you can surprise by giving a grace gift to. Let me help you. Maybe it's someone in your outdated past that did something for you when you were in a time of need. Maybe it's the person that won you to the Lord and you haven't had any contact with them for maybe years. But find someone that you expect nothing from in return and that will not be expecting to hear from you either. In fact, this is what I want you to do as you feel led and prompted of the Holy Spirit. I want you to write down the name of a person that you can give an unexpected gift to in the next 3.5 weeks. Why are you not moving? Put it in your phone. The Holy Spirit is speaking to you right now. To write down the name of someone in your past. Maybe it's a neighbor in your neighborhood that you've not even met. Maybe it's someone on the job that the Holy Spirit brings to your mind that would never expect anything from you. How about it? Because the best gifts that you or anyone will ever receive are unexpected gifts. Here's the second thing that I learned from these wise men. It's time that we give a gift with genuine joy. Don't you just love it when you're at a family gathering at Christmas time and somebody walks over and sticks a gift in your face with this sourpuss look on their face and they look like they've been baptized in dill pickle juice?
Here, this is what I got you.
I mean, really, do you enjoy receiving gifts from people like that? No. These wise men, this is what's prominent in the story of Matthew chapter 2. These wise men gave their gifts with genuine joy. They did so with such grace and fulfillment. The Bible said they rejoiced when they saw the star. The Bible said they rejoiced when they saw Mary. They could hardly wait to present their gift to the Christ child. Many years ago, I read a book by Richard Foster, and there was this little clip that I want to quote and share with you this morning. Giving with a glad and generous heart has a way of routing out the old tough miser within us. And here's something that really stood out. Even the poor need to know that they can give. Because just the very act of letting go of money or some other treasure does something within us. That something is, it destroys the demon greed. Wow. That's pretty powerful. Isn't that true? I heard one guy get up and pray this prayer, and I wanted to clock him. Lord, you can have anything you can pry out of my hand. Think about it. These wise men gave with genuine joy. Why? Because giving is a joy if we do it in the right spirit. What is the spirit I'm talking about? Well, it all depends on whether we think of it as this: what can I spare or what can I... Do you see the difference? When we give, we have to do it in the right spirit. And let me tell you something. Giving is not a competition among family members. I have some family members. Well, let's not go there. Number three. They might be watching. Just saying. Here's what else I learned from these wise men. How about this year giving a personal gift? Because joy that I just talked about comes when you give a personal gift. Give something of yourself. Maybe something that's even sacrificial. Because how many of you feel like it's a little bit impersonal when you go to a party or a banquet or a family gathering and everybody gets the same gift? Boring. When my late wife and I, our first year that we pastored the church in Canton, we wanted to do something special for the staff and the board and their wives, and we'd only been there for a few months, but at the Christmas party, we wanted to present each of them with a personal gift, not the same gift for the men and the same gift for the women. And so my wife and I spent several weeks, 5 or 6 weeks, finding out from their closest family members and friends what they collected, what did they like, where did they like to go to eat, what were some things they liked to do, what was their sport, their favorite hobby, whatever. And there was about 25 people that we had to find all of these details out about. And so we spent 5 or 6 weeks learning that, hey, Joe likes to fish, so we bought something for Joe that applied to fishing. And Mary, she collected these snow village things, I think, if I remember correctly. And so we got Mary a snow village figurine. And we found out what all 25 of the staff and council and their wives, and we got to the Christmas party, and we gave, it was such a joy to give every one of them a different gift for that Christmas. I've been gone from there for 30 years, and there are times when I connect with those people at a funeral or a gathering or something, and they'll say, Pastor, do you remember when you bought me that Snow Village figurine? I still have it, and every year when we put it out for Christmas, it makes me think of you and your wife. You see, we need to get back to the personal aspect of Christmas. Here's number four. These wise men teach me to give a gift that will last. I encourage you this morning that in the next 3.5 weeks, as you are preparing your gift list for the family and friends that you will be blessing this holiday season, that you will stop long enough to think about a gift that will last. Think about this. The gifts that these wise men gave have been heralded around the world for over 2,000 years. Did you ever stop to think about that? And do you know that you don't even have to be a Christian to know what the wise men gave? You can ask a heathen. You can ask a non-believer. Hey, what did the wise men give at Christmas time to the Christ child? Well, frankincense, gold, and myrrh. Why? Because they were gifts that lasted. They presented them. May I suggest that you can't purchase a gift that will last? What do you mean? Because gifts we buy wear out. They break. They get lost. Doug Lawson says this, and I love it. We exist temporarily through what we take, but we live through forever through what we give. There are two kinds of gifts that you can give at this Christmas time that will last forever. Write these down. Number one is the gift of memories. The gift of memories. One of the things that we need to really seize the moment and talk about today is about giving some gifts to your children, to your grandchildren, that will last because of a memory. Make sure that this Christmas you do some things that create memories. That's why Leslie wants all of us together in Tennessee at Christmas time. Christmas is her favorite time of the year. I'm more of a Scrooge type. Sorry. I just don't like the American Express bill in January. Can I get a witness? My wife, she loves to give. In fact, she has the gift of giving on my American Express. Can I get an amen from some men out there? Help me, guys. I need some help. I hope she's not watching today. That's why next year, if the Lord helps us to have a home here in Miami area, that we want to invite personally our staff, our team, our leaders, our council. We want to invite you. We don't want to have to go to a restaurant to have our Christmas party. We want to have it at our house. Why? Because we want to make memories. We want to spend time in a relaxed setting where we get to know one another. We can kick off our shoes and we can gather around a fireplace and we can sing Christmas carols. Memories are gifts that last. I want to encourage you to spend time making memories with the people that you love. Why? Because no one in this room is promised tomorrow. No one. Make some memories this year. My late wife and I, when we were pastoring our first church in Plymouth, we couldn't have children. We tried 11 years, went through 8 years of infertility to no success, and we were unable to get pregnant. Well, during the tenure of our pastorate there in Plymouth, Michigan, we established a relationship with the Church of God Smoky Mountain Children's Home. It's one of the missions that we support here at Cooper City. And here's what I want to share with you, because it's just a story of a gift that lasts forever, a memory. Every year, my wife and I would go to the home for children because during the 2 weeks of Christmas, they give all of the house parents 2 weeks off. And then in the summertime, they give all of the house parents that take care of all of the orphans and abandoned and abused children, they get a month off of the summer to be able to break away and have time with their family and take vacation. So my wife and I, being childless, we decided to go to the home and to get a kid or two to come and stay with us during the 2 weeks of Christmas and provide them with Christmas because we didn't have our own children at that time. And that went on for 8 years. In fact, our entire church, 1 year we brought 40 kids from the Church of God Home for Children back to Plymouth, Michigan for the 2 weeks of Christmas, and a family in our church would adopt those kids for 2 weeks and by Christmas and provide it for them. Well, there was one particular family, I won't mention by name, but had 12 children that they couldn't raise and take care of that lived in the Church of God orphanage. Nine of the 12 lived at the Church of God orphanage. And so we took in this young man. I think the first time he came to stay with us, he was 6 years old, and for 8 years until he was 14. In fact, he even came and lived with us a year and a half after this 8 years of relationship of just during the summer time and Christmas time. And so we established this relationship with this particular family. And even until this day, he's 40 years old now, and we still have a connection. We still are on Facebook, and we are excited. He's now married. He has two kids of his own. And a lot of these kids graduated after they got out of high school. If they were raised in the Church of God Home for Children, they had free tuition to go to Lee University. So many of these kids would go from the orphanage into Lee University and become ministers and evangelists and missionaries and doctors and lawyers and all of these things. And so I have so many fond memories of that 8 years that we brought those kids into our home. In fact, my son, who is 32, was adopted as a 16-week old boy from the Church of God Home for Children. And we have a place called Covenant Place, a home for unwed girls who find themselves pregnant, unmarried, and have nowhere to go. And my son's birth mother was 14 years old. And so I have a fond connection with the Church of God Smoky Mountain Children's Home. Not only because my son was a gift from there through a 14-year-old, very courageous young girl, but all of these memories that were made at Christmas time with all of the different children. Here's a second way that we can continue is by giving a godly heritage. Amen. That's another gift that will last. The Bible teaches that that will bless you for generations. I heard the story of a young couple that recently were saved and expressed their desire to begin to be the instruments that God used to start a godly heritage in their family lineage, because neither sets of their parents were saved and they only had one son, but the gift that they wanted to give and pass on to their son was a godly heritage that would begin to last in their family. And let me close with this, number five. This is another thing the wise men teach me. Give the gift now. Friends, look at me. Don't wait. Please. Give your grace gift this year. Don't wait for a more convenient time. Don't wait until you feel better. Don't wait until it's more fits into your schedule. Samuel Johnson made this statement, and it's pretty profound. Listen, he who waits to do a great deal of good all at once will never do anything. True? I believe that. Let me share this poem with you as I close. Listen carefully. They were going to be all they wanted to be tomorrow. None would be braver or kinder than they tomorrow. A friend who was troubled and weary, they knew, would be glad for a lift and needed it too. And on him they would call and see what they could do tomorrow. Each morning they stacked up the letters they'd write tomorrow and thought of the folks that they would fill with delight tomorrow. The greatest of people they just might have been. The world would have opened its heart up to them. But in fact, they passed on and faded from view. And all that they left when their living was through was a mountain of things they intended to do tomorrow. Can I encourage you today? short accounts. Last year, I received a phone call from my brother. His granddaughter, my great niece, was just days away from her 15th birthday. It was during the summer, and she was with four of her friends. The friend driving was 16, had just gotten her driver's license, and where I grew up in Franklin County, Southern Illinois, outside the city of Benton, there is what we call a ramp. And every person that I know, including myself, when you turn 16, you jump the ramp in your car. It's just a fun thing to do. So we thought. My niece was in the back seat with two of her friends, the driver and another young lady, 14, in the front seat. They got at the stop sign, and in her brand new Honda Civic, she decided to put the pedal to the metal before she hit the ramp. And it's basically a hill that will send you airborne if you hit it fast enough. And that's what we've all done. Everybody in my county that turned 16, everybody did it. But unfortunately, at 80 miles an hour, when that inexperienced 16-year-old driver hit the hill and went airborne, the car nosed down, hit the bridge, flipped twice in the air, and stopped by hitting two massive oak trees. And three of those five kids died instantly, including my great niece, just before her 15th birthday. Our family still grieves a year later, because at Christmas time, Thanksgiving, Josie isn't there. And we have to drive about 5 miles outside of town to a gravesite to celebrate with her. I said that and shared that story to say this. Give the gift now. The wise men were not about to go back home until they arrived to present their gifts to the king. And no doubt they pressed through struggles and time and opposition on the several months' journey to get to the city of David. But they did what they had set out in their hearts to do. Let me tell you something that I have experienced as a pastor for 44 years. The saddest moments in all of life is when families gather in funeral parlors wishing for one day back so that they could say or do something that they intended. Listen, I love you, but why wait? Why wait? Oh, but Pastor, the gift that I want to give is so expensive. Forget it. Give something that will last. Give them memories. Give them a gift that they can't repay. I know I'm sounding like an old man today, probably because I am. I'm not. Well, maybe I am. But hear my heart. Look at me, please. We can't let another Christmas go by without giving a gift that's worth giving. Would you stand with me? Amen. I hope you can come back next week. I want to talk to you about a gift worth receiving. And the week after, I want to talk to you about a gift worth waiting. And then we will conclude on December 22nd with a gift worth understanding. And I hope that this Christmas story and this series on the gift of giving, that you can extract some truths from the Word of God that you can apply practically to your life over the next 3.5 weeks as leads us to Christmas Day. Would you bow your heads with me this morning? Father, I'm so grateful for the privilege to be able to share these messages at the Cooper City Church of God. And I want us to pause and I want us to reflect. I want us to seize the moment this year. Not to be caught up in the hurry and scurry of the busyness of the season, but God, let us slow down for just a moment and breathe and ponder and meditate and enjoy the blessing of just being together. Lord, this morning as we talk about a gift worth giving, you told us in John 3:16 that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in him would not have to perish, but have this wonderful grace gift called everlasting life. And Holy Spirit, if there's anyone in this room today, maybe a prodigal son or daughter, maybe someone that has slipped away from the fold of grace, maybe someone, Lord, that's just been isolated and alone. You said in the Word, today's the day of salvation. Church, these last few days, I was able to be by myself for a few days at Thanksgiving in Texas. And all this week, preparing this message today, I add one prayer that I petitioned the Lord for. And I said, Father, if during the next 4 Sundays, the only thing that happens is one person who doesn't know Jesus will come to the saving knowledge of Christ, it will be worth every minute of study and prayer and preparation. And perhaps today there's someone in this room or someone that's watching online that would say, Pastor Rod, I'm a prodigal. I ran away from God some time ago. In the early service, I shared this because I kept hearing this song playing over and over and over. I know it's a secular song, but I kept hearing this song. And this is what it says. I'll be home Christmas. And you know what? I think there's someone in this room that wants to be home for Christmas. Not at your residence, not at your address, but in the family of God. Amen. And if that's you today, they're going to sing a beautiful song. And I'm going to give you an opportunity, if you'll just be patient for a moment and let the Holy Spirit work in people's hearts. The Word of God has gone forth, and it will not return void. But would you just worship with them? These altars are open. And if there is a prodigal son or daughter that would say, Pastor Rod, this year, I'm coming home for Christmas.